Okay, good afternoon, everybody. Then let's start unit number one. Let's continue the unit number one. And as we just started the first lesson, unit number one last week, that means the grade 9 contents we just started in the last lesson, and the online students also have joined with the video lesson. Somehow we just continue the lesson, the first unit. It's about the microorganisms. Let's recap what we have already discussed in the last week. Basically, we learned about the, basically we introduce what are called microorganisms, and in the Zoom meetings and also the physical class, we discussed the nature of, I mean, the who are called these microorganisms. Micro means small, and organisms means living beings. Yes, micro, very small organisms are the living beings, and there are five basic categories of living organisms. We just started them or studied them. Let's recall them. The main five categories: one type is bacteria, and yes, fungi, viruses, algae, protozoa. Yes, protozoa. So those are the five main groups of microorganisms, and in details we learnt about them, and also their environments we studied. So today we hope to learn about the importances or applications, maybe the effects of microorganisms. Applications means different fields that we use microorganisms. And the main title is the effects of microorganism. Let's see what we plan to do in today's lesson. Here you can see our plan. Effects of microorganisms. Under that we will learn about five or six useful effects. Number one, gene technology, nitrogen fixation, compost production, biopesticides, antibiotic productions, and the vaccine production. These are the six different effects that we hope to discuss. These are not the only effects that we need to discuss under this lesson. There are a number of other ones. So let's start from the first one. This is gene technology. Right, let's learn about the gene technology. To start or to introduce this one, basically we should know what are called these genes, right? And the word gene also a new word to you. Therefore, the first fact is learning about the genes. A gene is a chemical molecule or a fraction of a molecule that carries information from generation to generation or from organism to organism, and those genes found inside the cells of organisms. Cells are the basic units of organisms. Inside cells there are tiny molecules or the special molecules called DNAs. So gene is not a DNA, gene is a fragment of a DNA, small fraction, fragment of a DNA. And when you take one gene, it will carry one characteristic of an organism. As an example, if you take it to the human beings, our hair becomes black due to a kind of gene. Our hair becomes straight due to a kind of gene. So that gene instructs our hair cells to produce such hair, I mean the such type of hair. Likewise, each and every part which is created in our body just created according to the instructions of the genes. Set of genes can be called as kind of the best one is, it's just like a recipe, right? Those are the recipes. Oh, this is the one portion of a recipe, and the recipes are passing down from generation to generation. So how can we use this gene technology usefully with the microorganisms, right? Here there is an example. Think about this type of instance. Human beings have kind of gene which instruct our cells to produce a hormone called insulin, right? Then insulin hormone, lack of insulin hormone can cause diabetes. You have heard about diabetes. Some people call it as the sugar disease, but the sugar is not a disease. It is called diabetes. So if people suffering from the diabetes, the option for them is giving insulin, externally giving that insulin or injecting insulin. That is the option for it. But only human cells, there are particular cells in human beings which can produce insulin. Then, but when we make it industrially, there is no chemical process or machine to make insulin. So scientists now planning or the already planned and worked this type of thing. If there is a cell in our body which instruct or which produce the insulin, in that cell there is a gene which instruct this process. So by taking that gene out from the cell and introducing the gene into a bacteria type, when we introduce that gene into the bacteria, thereafter this bacteria also will get the ability to produce insulin. Gene is taken from a donor and thereafter it will be inserted into a recipient. This time recipient is a microorganism. Therefore, gene technology can be applied with microorganisms. This microorganism then can produce insulin hormone. So we can extract that hormone and again we can inject it back to the human beings. This is one example. Also, we can do it vice versa. If there are some particular genes in bacteria or such organisms, we can give them to another type of organism like plant. So genes can be with the gene technology, we can pass that genes from microorganism to a macroorganism like plant. By exchanging genes, we can produce new organisms with new outcomes. That is the gene technology. We can learn about some other examples after this. I will show you a video. Let's watch that video first. Here's the video. These are the basic principles of recombinant gene technology. It is a technology which a fragment of DNA from a donor cell organism is isolated. After isolating, we can insert that DNA to another cell or organism, right? So organism means a kind of microorganism or someone. Then it allows scientists to produce a new kind of organism by changing this. More simply, you can see that with the animation. In this animation, we can see there is a donor cell and a bacteria cell. So donor cell can be human or the any animal cell or a plant cell. So gene of interest has been taken out. Then the plasmid, or this is the circular DNA found in bacteria, we have taken the plasmid out. Thereafter, thirdly, we will cut off this DNA fragment using the enzymes. Actually, we can't cut that with scissors. This is a indicate kind of enzyme, a chemical. Using enzyme scissors, we can cut it to the specific point. Thereafter, we can cut and replace a fragment of the gene can be inserted in the plasmid, right? Now, using that enzymes we cut this off. Thereafter we have to paste it using DNA ligase. It is another chemical. Using the DNA ligase, we can plant this just like we just glue a piece into another one. Likewise, we can bond that. This is called recombinant plasmid. This recombinant plasmid will give a different output actually. Just as an as I explained here, this humulene, this is the example I took. Humulene is made by such process. Taking a gene from human being, thereafter planting or inserting that one into bacteria, then bacteria will produce the humulene or the human insulin likewise. And this is one application. Let's see another application here. Look at this video as well. Production of the golden rice. I think it is not in the full screen. 1 minute, please, till I arrange this. Right, now you can see this. So, a problem arises in the Philippines, especially the children in Philippines suffered from deficiency. Deficiency means lack of something, deficiency of vitamin A. And scientists decided to solve that problem. They identified the main problem behind these children as they are not taking sufficient amount of vitamin A rich food, just like vegetable and fruits. So according to their food style, food pattern, normally they eat a kind of animal food with rice. But although they are asked to eat vegetables or leaves, there was not progression of that. Therefore, the government of Philippines and some other countries decided to modify the rice by enrich the rice with the vitamin A. To enrich rice with vitamin A, they use the same theory. I mean the recombinant biotechnology was used here, or the recombinant gene technology was used by them. Right, just like this, they did it. So in laboratories, they took the gene which instruct the cells to produce vitamin A. They extracted that gene and introduced the gene into the paddy seeds. Once they are introduced into the paddy seeds, thereafter they got a product which is completely different than normal rice. This rice is called golden rice. Its color also different, and this rice is rich in vitamin A. It has the same taste, but naturally it contains vitamin A now. It's a genetical modified one. So this is the next example. So gene technology can be used in several ways. Either by introducing a DNA from animal or plant cell to a microorganism, or opposite manner, by taking a gene from the microorganism and introducing that to a plant or animal. That is how we can manage the genes in this microbial biotechnology. And now I will show you another similar simple diagram about this. Look at this. There's a regular fruit. It's prone to catch a lot of diseases. And there is an insect-resistant bacteria. As the insect damage this fruit, then we can take a gene from this bacteria and introduce to the fruit type. Fruit type means that plant. So, remove DNA fragment, or this is called the inserted gene. So, that gene can be taken. And we can introduce that with the genetic modification or by using the recombinant technology. Thereafter we can get an output insect resistant fruit. So there are such examples. One example is this: taking gene from Erwinia iridivora and introducing that to a paddy seeds, paddy plant, then we can produce, we have already produced this golden rice. There's another example. That example is taking the gene from Bacillus thuringiensis and introducing the gene to maize or corn, then insect resistant corns can be produced by this. Genetically modified corns can be produced by this process. Right. These are the applications of gene technology. Then let's write this down about gene technology. Page number 3. Okay, take your tutes and turn to the page number 3 and then let's write this down. In gene technology, recombination of gene of microbes, in gene technology, recombination of gene of microbes, gene of microbes with the gene of plant cell, with the gene of plant cell is done. With the gene of plant cell is done. Plant cell is done. Next. Disease resistant crops is an example here. Actually, the applications, disease resistant crops, that's an application. Second application, crops with higher nutritional quality. These are the applications of gene technology. Crops with higher nutritional quality. Next product, next outcome is improved vaccines for animal health. Hormones to enhance milk in cows. And enzymes to improve digestion. Right, those are the benefits of gene technology. And the next useful effect is the nitrogen fixation. It is a natural effect actually. Gene technology is an artificial thing, and the nitrogen fixation is a natural process. Let me explain how this nitrogen fixation works. Basic things, let's learn about them. Number one, nitrogen is a gas naturally existing in the atmosphere. And plants and animals both need this nitrogen. Plants and the animals, let's draw an animal as well. Plants and animals need this nitrogen. But there is a fact, you know. Plants can directly absorb carbon dioxide. Animals and plants both can absorb oxygen. Right? Carbon dioxide and oxygen we can directly take. But either of them, I mean a plant or an animal, they can't absorb nitrogen. Nitrogen is very essential. Nitrogen is a main element contained in protein. But there is no direct way to take. So what is the method of absorbing nitrogen? There should be someone who intermediate this process. Right? Somebody who need to convert nitrogen into absorbable form for plants. Therefore, there are several type of bacteria types who are living in the soil. Some bacteria live in as free bacteria in the soil. Some bacteria types found as the attached bacteria with the roots. There are parts called the root nodules. Some bacteria types are attached into that. So these bacteria can take nitrogen from the atmosphere, then they can convert into simple absorbable form, just like the nitrates or ammonium ions. So those ones can be absorbed by the plants. Plants can absorb them. When plants absorb them, from plants to the animals, they enter. So nitrogen, as the nitrogen cannot be absorbed by the plant or animal directly, the microorganisms intermediate or microorganisms convert that to usable form. Thereafter, we can absorb, we can take that nitrogen. So that is the path of the nitrogen entering into our bodies. Right. More simply, I will show that different types of microorganisms who are living in the root nodules and also in the soil. So this is an animation about those micro. 1 minute, please. Right here. Minute. This is it. When you go to the deep soil, we can see the root systems of plants and number of microorganisms living there. Fungi, nematodes, protozoa, bacteria, or such types are found in the soil. And many types of bacteria who are living in the soil are very important for the nitrogen fixation process. In 1 spoon of soil, about millions of bacteria, protozoa and fungi are living. So where do the nitrogen fixing bacteria are living? Some can live as attached one to the root nodules, right? Some can live as free microorganisms in the soil. So these free microorganisms, so attached microorganisms, can convert the nitrogen into usable nitrates or ammonium ions. That process is the nitrogen fixation. So this animation shows how nitrogen fixing bacteria provide nitrogen into the plants. So plants can absorb them. Right. Then we will see this. Look at this. Nitrogen fixation. Nitrogen in the air is converted by bacteria, then plants can absorb them. Microbes fix the nitrogen in nodules on the roots of the pulse crops. Right. This is one bacteria who's living in the soil. It is called rhizobium bacteria. There's another bacteria converts the nitrogen into the usable form or fixing nitrogen. It is Acetobacter bacteria. Acetobacter. And the last one is called Nitrosomonas. This bacteria is called Nitrosomonas bacteria. These are the three types of bacteria mainly involved in this process. Right? Nitrogen fixation process. Then we can write this also. Let's write down this fact in page number 3. Nitrogen fixation. Write this. Nitrogen fixation is a process. Nitrogen fixation is a process by which nitrogen in the atmosphere, by which nitrogen in the atmosphere is converted into usable form for plants. Nitrogen fixation is a process by which nitrogen in the atmosphere is converted into usable form for plants. Finished? Right. Then, next. The rhizobium bacteria that live on root nodule of some plants, the rhizobium bacteria that live on root nodules of some plants, root nodules of some plants supply nitrogenous substances to them. Nitrogenous substances to them. Okay, next. The bacteria like Acetobacter, look at the spellings from the screen. Acetobacter live in soil directly add fertilizer to soil. Directly add fertilizer to soil. Then the next useful effect is the compost production. And I think you might have heard last year mostly our government tried to introduce the organic farming. Compost is one of branch in the organic farming, but organic farming does not mean the using only compost for the products. It is an advanced process, organic farming. Compost is one need for the organic farming, because the fertilizer used in the organic farming is the compost. And the process of compost production, how can we produce the compost? Then let's talk about the compost production process. Generally, we can't use each and every waste matter to produce compost. Compost is a product produced by the waste materials, right? Naturally, this process takes place as the decomposition, right? In nature, this is naturally occur. Decomposition process is a natural process. Decomposition is a natural process, naturally take place in the environment, right? And minute, please. Wait a bit. Okay. So, who engage or which sort of creatures, which sort of organisms engage in the decomposition process? Yes, there are microorganisms, but not only the microorganisms. Some insects also help this process. Some annelids like earthworms also helpful to this. Yes, there are different organisms. Basically, think about this sort of instance. If a plant is died off, then plant will fall down on the ground. Plant body will be fallen down on the ground. Then the plant, once it is fallen down, then what happens? First, some macroorganisms will start to break this into tiny pieces. Right? Thereafter, the insects like termites will act on the stem parts. They also will break or loosen it up. Some worms, right, will come and start the decaying process. But who complete the final touch? They are the microorganisms. Microorganisms can convert this whole plant into the soil, dark black soil, within 6 months or 12 months. In a short period of time, you can't find even a sign of a plant in that place. Completely that will be converted or the re-adds into the soil. So the microorganisms लाइक बैक्टीरिया एंड फंगाई, बैक्टीरिया एंड फंगाई मेनली सपोर्ट दिस प्रोसेस, दैट इज द डिकम्पोजिशन प्रोसेस. सो इन कंपोस्ट प्रोडक्शन वी यूज द सेम प्रिंसिपल और द सेम सपोर्ट फ्रॉम द माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिज्म. When producing compost, you can't use each and every waste matter. I mean, polythene, plastic, glass, so such things we can't use. So always we have to use only the organic matters, such as the kitchen waste we can use. But remember, we need to use the vegetable, the waste or the leftovers, fruit leftovers, or uncooked types. Cooked food takes long time to decompose. Right, some kitchen waste that we are throwing out from the kitchen, and dried leaves, or once we the mowed grass, or such things we can put together. Thereafter, we can follow the we can support the microorganisms to do the decomposition. Now I will show another simple diagram or about the process of decomposition, process of producing compost. Look at this. Here are the waste materials or the vegetable or fruit waste that we can use for the decomposition. We have to collect it in a separate bin, in a compost bin, but this is not the place where we make it. Thereafter, we have to make a compost box or compost the bin means the special kind of heap or something. Thereafter, we should add that waste. Thereafter, we should, after adding the vegetable waste, then we can add two things: what is important for the microbial action, also a sample of compost. This is very important because this sample brings the microorganism types to this compost box. That microorganism type will quickly spread and continue this process, this decomposition process. Time to time we have to add water to keep enough wetness and the warmth of this. Then at last we can take this output. This is the compost, environmental friendly fertilizer. So we can use our kitchen waste or the other the grass or the leaf waste to produce compost, and we need the support of microorganisms for this. Okay, here this is a zoom view of a compost sample under microscope. So you can see different living beings here. This is a fungi type, and these are these tiny circular ones, they are bacteria types. Also some protozoans are seen. This is a compost sample under microscope. Right, now let's write this down about the compost production. Page number 3, still we are in the same page. Write this down. Microorganisms are major decomposers. Microorganisms are major decomposers who degrade dead plants and animals, who degrade dead plants and animals and return the nutrients back to the soil, and return the nutrients back to the soil. Microorganisms are major decomposers who degrade dead plants and animals and return the nutrients back to the soil. Okay, finished. Write the next one. There's a mistake here. First and second rules needed for the first point, and then shift this point to the third rule. You can see it on the screen. See the screen and change that. Shift, erase this one and draw new one here. Okay, then write these two points. First point, actinomycetes, comma, बैक्टीरिया एक्टिनोमाइसिटिस बैक्टीरिया एंड फंगाई टाइप्स आ एंड फंगाई टाइप्स आ द मेन डिकम्पोजर्स एक्टिनोमाइसिटिस बैक्टीरिया एंड फंगाई टाइप्स आर द मेन डिकम्पोजर्स आर द मेन डिकम्पोजर्स बैक्टीरिया एंड फंगाई टाइप्स आर द मेन डिकम्पोजर्स. नेक्स्ट, दिस माइक्रोब्स आर यूजफुल इन मेकिंग फर्टिलाइजर्स. दिस माइक्रोब्स आर यूजफुल इन मेकिंग फर्टिलाइजर्स. दिस माइक्रोब्स आर यूजफुल इन मेकिंग फर्टिलाइजर्स. यूजफुल इन मेकिंग फर्टिलाइजर्स. यूजफुल इन मेकिंग फर्टिलाइजर्स. राइट, देन स्टिल वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट सम एग्रीकल्चरल इफेक्ट्स और यूजेस ऑफ माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स. फॉर जीन टेक्नोलॉजी वी कैन यूज देम. देन आफ्टर फॉर द कंपोस्ट प्रोडक्शन एंड ऑल्सो जस्ट बिफोर दैट वी लर्न हाउ द माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स कैन बी यूज टू यूज फॉर द नाइट्रोजन फिक्सेशन. नेचुरल प्रोसेस ऑफ प्लांट नाइट्रोजन फिक्सेशन. All these effects are important for plants. And the next one also the same. That is called biopesticides. When talking about the organic farming, we need fertilizers. We can supply that fertilizer needs by the compost fertilizer. And also we need methods to control pests. And last year in grade 8 we learned who are called pests. Pest is an organism which always harm our crops. So when we cultivate a crop, we need to protect our crops from pests. For that we need to control pest. We have to take some actions to control pest types, different pest types. And the most famous method of controlling pest is the chemical controlling. By spraying harmful chemicals, we can control or completely kill those pest types. Controlling means that we can slow down their action by chemicals, or completely we can kill and destroy them. But the harm occurred due to the chemical with the agrochemicals or that pesticides, artificial or chemical pesticides, it's harmful to the environment. And also useful animals can die. There are a number of useful animals here. They also can die. So, using chemical fertilizer is not a good option to control pests. What is the option then? Using biological pests or biopests, biopesticides, pesticides, sidal means killing, right? To kill pest, we can use the biological pest. As an example, think about this sort of thing. One, imagine that there is an insect, right? A pest who harms our crops, eats the leaves in the crops. One method of controlling this one is spraying chemicals to kill it. But that is not a long-lasting option. Next season also, these creatures will come. We have to use the agrochemicals again. What is the long-lasting option? What is the environmental-friendly option? Option is this. We have to find natural enemy of this. Like the human beings get sick with the microorganisms, so viruses or fungi or bacteria types can make us sick. Right? As we are getting sick with the diseases, there should be microorganisms who cause sickness to these small insects. Some microorganisms will completely kill them out. So our task is finding such organisms, finding such creatures. If we can find such type of, imagine bacteria type, So we have to spread this bacteria in our farm or our agricultural field. Then that bacteria will naturally grow or enter their body and destroy them. And this is the pest is our enemy. Is an enemy. Bacteria is the enemy of that enemy. Enemy of enemy is a friend. So this bacteria is a friend of us. Okay, because it destroy one of harmful creature to us. Us means the crops. That's the process of biopesticides. Using microorganisms to destroy or control the pests. I think this is clear enough. I will show you a graphic as well. Watch this graphic. See this graphic, then we can understand furthermore. Here, biopesticides. Maybe some plant extracts, toxic or poisonous for them, or bacterium, fungi, viruses, or nematodes can be toxic or harmful to them. Then, one option, Bacillus thuringiensis, the harmful bacteria to mosquito larva. When we spread Bacillus thuringiensis in water bodies, then they will damage the mosquito larva. Then we can control mosquitoes by this bacteria. Another option, this is a fungi type called Alternaria fungus. This fungus is harmful to a weed. This weed is Salvinia weed, normally grow in the aquatic environments. So to destroy the Salvinia, we can use Alternaria fungus. It grows in its root system and destroy the root system. Thereafter, plant will die. They are long-lasting options and environmental friendly options. Right. This is in page number 4, no? Next page. Look at that. Yes. This one is in page, yes, page number 4, biopesticides. Yes. Let's write this down. Look at the screen and write the note down. Ready? Okay. Microbial biopesticides consist of a microorganism. Microbial biopesticides consist of a microorganism as the active ingredient. Microbial biopesticides consist of a microorganism as the active ingredient. Microbial biopesticides consist of a microorganism as the active ingredient. As the active ingredient. An example, Bacillus thuringiensis or BT bacteria, within bracket BT. Bacillus thuringiensis bacterium is used to, Bacillus thuringiensis bacterium is used to destroy the larval stages of insects. To destroy the larval stages of insects. Bacillus thuringiensis bacterium is used to destroy the larval stages of insects. Next one. Alternaria fungus is used to destroy Salvinia plants. Alternaria fungus is used to destroy Salvinia plants. Right. With this, we will mark the end of the first set of effects. They are related to the agriculture. So, using fertilizers, using biopesticides or improved gene technology and nitrogen fixation are usefully used in the agricultural field. Then we will move on to another field. This is the medical field. Microorganisms are very important in the medical field, especially when talking about the medicines or medicine production. We get sick due to the microorganisms. Right. due to the action of microorganisms. And also, we can find the solution for such sicknesses from microorganisms. Microorganisms are between friends and foes, right? The harmful microorganisms cause sicknesses, and useful microorganisms, they will help us to control the sicknesses. Now, first I'll explain how we heal a kind of disease or once without taking treatment. So by taking treatments, we can heal our condition, sicknesses, right? To cure a sickness, right? To cure a sickness, we need to follow some steps. Number one, our body has natural ability of fighting against a germ. Let's learn how we get sick and how our body react to this. Our body gets sick due to the entrance of harmful microorganisms. We call them germs or maybe pathogens. Pathogens. If a pathogen is enter into our body, then the body processes will get malfunction or abnormal. Due to that, the body will get sick. Some symptoms will appear then. Rising of fever, the appearance of some the patches in the skin, or maybe tiredness, lethargicness, different symptoms will come due to the sickness. But one thing you have to remember this, our body has natural mechanism to fight against this. Our body has an army force. If germs are the enemies, once these enemies enter our body, enemies, let's write it as enemies, once they enter into our body has an army force to fight against that. That army force is the white blood cells, leukocytes and lymphocytes, right? White blood cells means the leukocytes or the white blood cells or the lymphocytes. There is a system called lymphatic system in our body. That army force create kind of immunity against a disease. Especially this is the only way to fight against viruses, right? If a virus enter our body, the only option is the body must fight against this. These army soldiers need weapons to fight. Those weapons are called antibodies. Antibodies. Right? With antibodies, then we can destroy the virus. But if there is a natural mechanism, why do we get sick? There's another question. Why can't this army force control all the viruses, all the bacteria or such things? Actually, there is a limit or maximum strength of controlling it. If more number of pathogens or more powerful pathogen comes, sometimes our body also will fail to fight against it. The strength of the army force will not enough, or weapons it has will not enough. Weapons are the antibodies will not be enough. If so, then we need to support the body to cure this condition. There are two options. If the attack is a bacterial attack, we can directly give the weapons to the army force. Means taking pills with antibiotics. We call them antibiotics. Antibiotics. Antibiotics are kind of medicines. These antibiotics can enter and our army force, I mean the defense mechanism or the defense force, lymphocytes and the other white blood cells, they will use the support of the antibiotics to destroy bacteria. But for viruses, there is no such option. I mean, viruses cannot be controlled by the antibiotics. Remember it thoroughly. Viruses cannot be controlled with the antibiotics. These days we are fighting with a disease. It's a viral disease. COVID-19 is a virus. So we are fighting with that one. The option to fight against that is production of antibodies in our body. Our body must make the resistance against it. External supports will not work. That means we have to train our army force. We have to train these lymphocytes to or the other white blood cells to fight against the virus, fight against the virus and control the virus. So the problem is still our body cells are not capable of doing so. Only option that we have seen is the people get sick, then they build the immunity. Sometimes that sickness can be led to the death. Therefore, we need to empower the body to survive in such condition. What is the option for this? That time we have an option. It is the vaccination. So vaccines will not give any antibiotic to the body, but vaccines will help the body to build antibodies against a virus. Virus can be controlled by building antibodies. Vaccines will help to that. And if you see the next two chapters, that's about the antibiotics and the vaccine production. Please change the second topic, right? Second topic, it's a mistake here in the page number four. Look at the page number four and change this. First one, antibiotic production, it is okay. Second topic, also the same antibiotic production. Cut off that, right? Okay, cut off that one. Right, now cut that off. Then write it as vaccine production. Okay, second topic, second one. Cut and change as vaccine production. Second one is vaccine production. Actually, before introducing or before explaining that, I explained you how our body gets sick, what sort of germs can make our body sick, and how can we act against different type of germs. Against bacteria or fungi, we can fight with the antibiotics, antibiotic medicines. Against the viruses, we have to fight with antibodies which are built by our body itself. To empower the process, we need to give vaccines. Vaccines are several types. I'll explain how vaccines can be used. Now let's move on to the further description for the explanation of the antibiotics. This is about how antibiotic work against. 1 minute till I find this video. Okay, with this animation you can understand how antibiotic works against a germ or a pathogen. Once we take antibiotic pill, it will be dissolved in the stomach, most probably in the stomach and in digestive system. We can absorb it to the into the bloodstream. You can see the meaning here. Antibiotics can be bactericidal or bactericidal. Static means controlling or stopping, and cidal means killing. Antibiotics can stop the action of bacteria or killing the bacteria. Then, this is the bacteria capsule or the bacteria type. So, antibiotics can attack the DNAs of the DNA means just like the brain of this bacteria. Then the antibiotics can attack and destroy the DNA code. Once the DNA code is destroyed, then there is no way to sustenance of it. Also, antibiotics can stop the processes or the living processes of the bacteria to destroy that. And also, the protein production units can be destroyed. These units are called ribosomes. And there is another way of destroying the bacteria by an antibiotic. that is the destruction of the wall of the bacteria, breaking of wall. Once the antibiotics or antibiotic chemicals destroy the wall of the bacteria, then bacteria will destroy or the split off into fragments like this. And penicillin is a bactericidal antibiotic. What is penicillin and how it was discovered? Actually, discovery of penicillin is a nice story. This is about the discovery of penicillin. In this story, I will explain how penicillin was invented or discovered by that accidental event. Look at this. The person called Alexander Fleming, he was the supporter of a doctor. His own brother was the doctor, and they were doing some experiments about bacteria, right? They were growing bacteria in different as different cultures for their experiments. Somehow one day when he was left for a vacation, he was unable to close, or he was forgotten to close one small growth culture, right? Therefore he noticed that thereafter, once he come back after the vacation, he noticed that kind of new organism has grown over these microorganisms. Also, due to that new organism, the bacteria has been destroyed, right? Once he given to close look at that, he noticed that one as a fungi type. This fungi produces a chemical which destroys the bacteria. Name of the fungus is Penicillium notatum. So he and his brother and their team work with this one to extract that particular chemical. Finally, they were able to extract that chemical, the chemical secreted by the fungi. Once they extracted the chemical, then they introduced the chemical into with a particular filtration process. Then they used it and bottled that as the particular liquid or particular substance. And first with the animals, they experimented to control some bacteria, harmful bacteria, make the animals sick. And thereafter, finally, they made a medicine for human beings from this. And using fungi, we produce this medicine. It is called penicillin. Penicillin is a famous antibiotic used in nowadays to control the bacterial infections. We use it. Now, thereafter, there are a number of such things were discovered. Look at this. Antibiotic production, or the process goes on like this. Penicillium growth was taken. Thereafter, we send it to the fermentation tank. Finally, penicillin molecule was extracted and packed it as the antibiotic. Now, as pills or capsules, we can take this antibiotic. And there are number of antibiotic types now we use. At present, we use number of antibiotics. Here, there are some examples for them. Penicillin, amoxicillin, erythromycin, tetracycline, greaseofulvin, or such one. Greaseofulvin is used against the fungi types. Likewise, these are called antibiotics. That's the story about antibiotic production. Antibiotics are weapons given to the body to fight against the germs. Germs means pathogens. Okay? Right. Long story. Little bit boring, but let's write the answer. Let's write the note. Antibiotics. Antibiotics are natural substances that can be used against bacteria infections. Antibiotics are natural substances that can be used against bacteria in bacterial infections, write L letter, bacterial infections, bacterial infections. Explain it further. Antibiotics cannot be used to destroy viruses. Antibiotics cannot be used to destroy viruses. Please highlight this or put a star mark or something. This is very special point. This is a special point. Antibiotics cannot be used to destroy viruses. Destroy viruses. Next. They are produced and secreted naturally. They are produced and secreted naturally by bacteria and fungi. They are produced and secreted naturally by bacteria and fungi. Bacteria and fungi. Produced and secreted naturally by bacteria and fungi. Examples, number of examples there. Penicillin, amoxicillin, erythromycin, penicillin, amoxicillin, erythromycin, tetracycline, griseofulvin, penicillin, amoxicillin, erythromycin, tetracycline, griseofulvin. Okay. Still writing. Right, good. So the next story is about vaccines. Ready? Vaccines. Vaccines can be used against viruses. But the vaccines are different types. What sort of things are the vaccines? Actually, vaccines are the controlled real viruses. Right? I mentioned this. Given or the vaccination is something like training our body or training this the immunity making or this army force, training the leukocytes and the white blood cells to fight against the virus. So without having training sessions, they can't train. How can we train an army force to fight against the enemy? They need to face the enemies or dummies of enemies. Enemies or dummies of enemies. If the real enemy is sent, sometimes the enemy will kill the army force. So army force will be destroyed. Okay? Therefore, what we do here? We need to introduce the enemy to the army force. But the method is this. Before introducing to the enemy to the army force, we never introduce the full strength enemy. That means full strength virus will not be given to the body. Half controlled virus can be given. It is called attenuated viruses. Half controlled viruses. So that virus will not make us sick. But the fighting mechanism of the immunity will build in our body. So that means the antibodies can be built when this attenuated virus is entered. For some diseases, we use this technique. Sometimes, if this also a dangerous one, we can use completely inactive virus. Inactive. It is just like fighting with the dummy. Dummy can't fight against that, but we can fight with the dummy and practice. Right? Fighting with the dummy. Then, with antibodies, antibodies can be produced by fighting with the inactive ones. Third one is introducing the weapons used by that. I mean, if they produce kind of toxic, we, without sending the virus into the body, we send the toxic, we inject the toxin to the body. When the toxin is given, then body will learn or body will train to practice to control the toxic, right? That is the next method. Likewise, we can use different techniques when making vaccines. The modern one is most developed or advanced technology of making vaccine is use the genetic or the gene technology to produce the vaccines. Genetics. Talking about vaccine is very important because you know that nowadays we are fighting with a virus, COVID-19 virus. That although we call it COVID-19, now we have there are number of variants of it, different variations. And when fighting with the different variations, we need to fight, or the only method of controlling that is the vaccination. Vaccination process has started, and there are different vaccines. What sort of vaccines you might have heard? Now, there are different names of vaccines. What are the famous vaccines used in Sri Lanka, all around the country, all around the world, I mean? Yeah, one is Sinopharm. Right, Sinopharm or Sinopharm, that's the well, it's one of famous one, and Pfizer, yes. And have you heard AstraZeneca? Yes. Sputnik? Yes. Sputnik virus, Moderna virus, okay, yes. There are such different viruses, vaccines. Vaccines, I said viruses, not so. What sort of vaccines? Again, let's recall them, Sinopharm, Pfizer, Moderna, Sputnik, Sinovac. Sinovac is another one. AstraZeneca. Different vaccines. But those vaccines are not similar. That is the next fact. Right? There are vaccines, but they are not similar. Some are attenuated. Some use attenuated viruses. Some use the inactive ones. Some use the control toxic or the genetically modified ones also. I think Pfizer vaccine is such a genetically changed vaccine. Right? I'll show you some images, I mean the kind of slides about this, about the vaccination or the vaccine process. Vaccine production. Okay. Here there's a vaccine here, then you can first let's write this. No, that's better. We changed the topic, you know this, we changed the topic. The online students also, you have to change your topic here in page number, yes, 4. Change the topic to vaccine production and write this small note. A vaccine is a product that produce. Vaccine is a product that produce immunity. A vaccine is a product that produce immunity from a disease and can be given through from a disease and can be given through an injection or mouth. Immunity from a disease and can be given through an injection or mouth. An injection or mouth. Right. Look at this. There are live attenuated vaccines, inactivated or killed ones, subunit or the purified antigens, toxoid vaccines, different types. Here I am comparing different vaccines used for different diseases. Attenuated vaccines. Right. In them we use half controlled viruses. half controlled viruses, just like that polio vaccine which is used against the polio. It is given orally through the mouth. That is one type of vaccine. For COVID-19, it was tried. There are some clinical trials, but successfully it was not created or not made. It was not successful actually. Then, inactivated viruses can sorry not vi viruses inactivated viruses or the inactivated viruses can be used to inactivated vi vaccines. For influenza virus is successfully used also for the COVID-19 virus. Sinovac, Sinopharm, Bharat Biotech is the Indian vaccine. They are kind of inactivated vaccines, right? Look at these names. These are popular in our society now. Next one, viral vector vaccines. Viral vectors, that means using that toxin and fighting with this. Such ones are the AstraZeneca vaccine made by the Oxford University. Oxford, these are the British ones. It can be used for the Ebola. I mean, this sort of vaccines are used for the Ebola also. And AstraZeneca is such attempt. It was successfully made, and also now it is approved to inject into the people. The last, genetic vaccines, genetic ones. The famous brand name is Pfizer vaccine, and Moderna vaccine, BioNTech and Moderna, those viruses also, those vaccines also, such genetic vaccines, right? And genetic vaccines uses genes to control the virus, and once it is injected, then once it enters the body, it helps the body to produce antibodies. Remember, these vaccines cannot control the virus. Vaccine is a virus itself. Our body's body gets the ability or the strength, we call it immunity, to fight against the virus once the vaccine is given. Okay, if you see the page number 4, you can see the descriptions here. Okay, look at the descriptions. Live attenuated vaccines, inactivated vaccines, toxoid vaccines. Examples also given with that. No, attenuated vaccines are measles, tuberculosis, polio. Inactivated virus vaccines are used for cholera, influenza, and the typhoid fever. Toxoid vaccines used for tetanus and diphtheria. DNA or genetically modified vaccines used for hepatitis B. Now, if you want, you can note this down. That is used as the Pfizer vaccine for COVID-19, and toxoid vaccines. The AstraZeneca vaccine is a toxoid vaccine. Inactivated one is that Sinopharm, Sinovac, right? Such vaccines, the Bharat Biotech, those vaccines are inactivated types used for the COVID-19. And this is the end of today's lesson or the content that we plan to do. And we will end the session for the online students. And you know that the worksheet discussion, once we discuss the worksheet, we will upload the worksheet with this video. So you have to do the worksheet and participate the Zoom meeting, which is holding on the on Thursday. Right. This is the end of the second video or second lesson of unit number 1. Okay. Goodbye, everybody. And let's start.